My name is Roshaneh Zafar. I am the founder and managing director of Kashf Foundation, and today I'm going to be talking to you about my success story for UKVibe TV. We are going to be talking a lot about my journey, but essentially it's a journey of women's economic empowerment. So let us proceed. I'm an economist by training, and I have been working in the field of women's development and economic development for the past 25 years. My focus is primarily the economic empowerment of women. So when we talk about the empowerment of women, of course, it's a very complex issue, and my focus has been on helping women set up small businesses within their homes. And it becomes a conduit for change, both for the family and themselves. So they set up businesses where they earn an income, and that income is then reinvested in the welfare of the family. So essentially, if you want to define the work that we do, it's the field of microfinance, which was started by Professor Yunus of the Grameen Bank in Bangladesh. Well, yes, definitely. I grew up in Lahore, having been from this city, I feel it's one of the most dramatic cities of Pakistan, because it really it is the repository of our history. They say if you start digging within the levels of Lahore, you will see the history of South Asia etched in that geology. So that being said, I definitely grew up in Lahore, and I consider myself to be a product of this city. But in our times, when we were growing up in the late 70s, early 80s, things were very different. It was an organic time. We could actually go out and walk about in our neighborhoods. Life was very uncomplicated. These days, you don't have children getting that sense of different classes and different groups. So when I was growing up, for me, Lahore was really an adventure. So we would be, going by foot everywhere. We would take local transport. We would interact with people on the streets. For me, food street from Lahore was really part of my childhood. So every time I go within the city, I think of all the wonderful food I ate as a child. But you don't get the same thing anymore. You don't get that flavor of the old times of Lahore. So for me, Lahore is a cultural fix, if you want to say put it like that. However, I also consider myself to be a Pakistani, and I see that having worked across Pakistan, there is a lot of affinity that the city has. It's also a city that has absorbed different cultures. At one time, it was very provincial. 20 years ago, if you looked at Lahore, it was a provincial capital. But today, Lahore has become very cosmopolitan. It actually reflects, in a way, a melting pot as well of not just Punjab, but the rest of the country. So it's, in some ways, it has mimicked what Karachi was for Pakistan 50 years ago. So it's very diverse, and it also brings together a lot of different groups. So that's what Lahore represents for me today. And my work represents that as well, because we are a national program. We work across the country. We are very proud of our heritage. We are very proud of our being an indigenous organization that reflects the values and ethnicities and diversity of Pakistan. Kashf Foundation was established in 1996 as the first microfinance institution in Pakistan that was targeting women entrepreneurs. Now, there were many firsts in this whole thing. The first thing was that in Pakistan, nobody had actually picked up the Grameen Bank model, which was started in Bangladesh. We've already mentioned that, by Dr. Yunus. And brought over to Pakistan for replication. So we were the first ones to actually study that model, go out there, really, really understand the fundamentals of how microfinance for women should work, then bringing it back here and piloting it here, and then showing that it could succeed. So I think that was one of the first things we did. The second first was that we work only and only for women. And this continues to be the raison d'etre of the institution. And as I had already mentioned earlier, our focus is the economic empowerment of women, where we help them in two or three ways. So the first thing we do is we sit with the women and their families, and we try to understand what is their business potential. What is the entrepreneurial venture that they are currently running or would like to run? And what are the pros and cons of doing that? So we do a business planning exercise. These are very simple conversations, but we help the women understand the strengths and weaknesses of their little project. Then we train them, and we train them in financial education and business management, and we also educate the family regarding the importance of women's worth. Because a lot of times families in low-income communities or in patriarchal settings do not give value to women and the economics or the participation that they can contribute to the income in the family. So we also work with the families and do gender trainings with them. So that's another component that we work at. Once that process is individualized and the entrepreneur is ready, so to speak, we then give them funding. And that financing is based on their ability to of their business to repay and the ability of the entrepreneur to grow their business. So basically our focus is to help women set up micro businesses within their environment, which then provides them income, which then they save out of or they invest in their families, they grow their businesses. However, that's not where we stop. We also work on advocacy, because one of the things we realized is you can't isolate an entrepreneur, female entrepreneur, from her society. And it's also important to work with society and to work on other issues and you know, gender attitudes. So we have an advocacy program where we do theater, we work with youth, we do gender trainings for boys. We also run a school program where we work with low-cost private schools. These are essentially schools that have been privately set up by entrepreneurs in low-income communities. So we train the entrepreneur, we train the teachers, and we also finance the schools with the end vision that the quality of education that is available to low-income families can improve. So we do a holistic approach when it comes to development, but our primary focus continues to be funding women-led businesses so that this can lead to poverty alleviation, and it can also lead to the economic empowerment of women in terms of enhancing their financial decision-making capacity. Well, as one of my favorite things about Pakistan is the cultural diversity. It's just amazing. You start from the north and you come down to the south and everything changes. And I think that's the beauty of the country. And I feel, as I was already mentioning to you, I'm very proud of my heritage. I'm very proud to be a Pakistani. And I think the second thing that you can talk about Pakistan is our cuisine. Oh, we have the most amazing food. And it changes at every level, at every delta, at every plane. And yet it is just, you know, whoever has eaten our food falls in love with it. And I think the third thing that I really love is the indigenous crafts that we have. We have some beautiful crafts. Unfortunately, we haven't preserved them so well. If I had my way, I would really make a museum of crafts and really put them out there. But museums are not good enough. I think what we also need to do is make sure that there is a value-driven approach to reviving crafts in Pakistan. Our neighbors have done it well, much better, because it was something that the government invested in. So I think we have a lot of cultural diversity. As I said, our food is great, our terrain is beautiful, and our people are dynamic. What we do lack, and we all know that, is leadership, and I think that's really the crux of the matter. And one day I'm hopeful we'll get the right leaders. Yes, as I mentioned to you earlier, we have a very strong focus on advocacy. And advocacy is something that is, you know, when I started in microfinance, Dr. Yunus told me, he said, designing a financial product for low-income women is not going to be your challenge. It's been done before many, many times. But your real challenge is going to be about changing mindsets. And that continues to be, you know, you were asking me earlier also, what is your challenge as an entrepreneur? It's not the practical, you know, implementation, operational side, functional side of the work. It's really the qualitative change you want to see. You want people to think differently. You want people to know what dignity means. You want people to uphold each other's relationships with respect. There has to be mutual collaboration. These are all qualitative things you want to see. So one of the things we've seen over the years is, as we know, that violence against women, violence against children, is a part of society that we really need to impact on. So our advocacy work looks at impacting on many of these social problems. And we've been doing advocacy for 20 years, and as I was mentioning, we do theater. Theater is a tool we use. It's social theater. We take a social issue up, for example, age at marriage, child marriage for girls, or it could be girls' education, it could be domestic violence, and we do small theater performances in different communities, and then we do a praxis of engagement with the audience. You know, let's say the latest theater we have is of this young girl whose father has sold her in marriage to a 40-year-old. And it's the night before she's to be married. She's 13 years old. And she's having a conversation with her doll. So these are very powerful images that we have. There's this one little girl sitting on stage talking to her doll and saying, "What will happen to me tomorrow?" And so on and so forth. So we try to engage with the audiences to help them think about issues, you know, why do we do these things and what impact this has. So out of this whole 20 years of working with theater and drama in communities, we started looking at other avenues. And Pakistan, as you know, one of the other things we have is our music and our television talent. We have very dynamic private television channels that run their own soap operas or telenovelas or dramas, whatever you want to call them. So we thought, we've used drama, theater, on the street or in communities. Why not use drama serials, which are very, very popular, and make them develop, you know, a concept of edutainment, education and entertainment together. So our first venture was in 2013 called Rihai. And the focus of that drama serial was child marriage and girls' education. And of course, domestic violence and so on and so forth. The second issue that we took up, which was much more, a little more, I shouldn't say controversial, but difficult, sensitive to present to audiences, was child sexual abuse. Now, this again is not just a Pakistani social problem. It's an international problem. We all know that. It's rarely talked about, at least in Pakistan. So we wanted to get the genie out of the bag and say, well, let's talk about this. The first step is recognize there's a problem. And the second step is to do something about it. So Udari came out of that. But when we were developing this, we realized that we really needed to make this a little more epic in its scale. So we added the second track, which was the music track. So there's one story which is very stark of this little girl who's being abused by her stepfather. And then there's this other story where there's a band a music band which is just in the making. So we tried to put them together, and that's what gave the traction to the story. And people could watch the very difficult parts because there was a counter track to it where there was more entertainment and music. So this was in some ways a first of its kind because it was the first musical serial done in Pakistan, and it had the issue of child sexual abuse. And we feel that because of this, there are other dramas that are coming up which are more socially conscious, and they are looking at issues more sensitively than they have done before. The other thing we did in Udari was, and you asked me what our role was, we were the co-producers basically. So we were the co-creators of the story, the script, the development, the casting, and looking at the production and the characterization. So our role was overall in terms of the play. But one of the other things we also did was, if you look at statistics internationally in media, even Hollywood, only 30% of the speaking roles are given to women. That's 70% go to men. These are statistics that were taken, that I'm reporting from a Hollywood research group that actually looked at this. So what we did was, in our place, women get major roles. They're the ones that have very impactful, they become role models. So many of the characters that we've shown in the play, then we're not showing women as victims. That's not the idea. And the other idea behind our projects is not to just, you know, to show a problem and exit. The idea is to show a solution as well. So there has to be hope. So in all the advocacy work that we've done, we've also shown hope. So that's really Udari in a nutshell. Currently at Kashf, we have about 2,500 staff, and they're spread across 205 branches across Pakistan. The other important thing to note is that 50% of our staff population is females and 50% is men. So we have a very strong focus on gender equity. You know, unless or until we demonstrate it in the organization, you can't have it replicated in the field and the community. So we try to balance that. And our constant focus is on building women leaders, on making sure there isn't a glass ceiling in the institution. That continues to be a struggle, of course, but we do work on that. We also, for example, to promote women's retention, we have a program which I like to call Not Without My Mother-in-Law. What that means is a lot of times we have a young team in terms of age. So many of the young women who are working with us, once they get married, there's pressure for them to leave the job market. So then what we do is we work with their families. We invite and engage their future in-laws to come and visit our office and see the environment and get the confidence that their future daughter-in-law will be safe in the organization. Then we also have another scheme which we've recently started, which is Women on Wheels. What that is, we are giving scooties to our staff because one of the biggest problems in Pakistan is transportation. Women do not have access to transportation. You know, their cars are unaffordable, so they can't ride motorbikes because it's not socially acceptable. So what we are promoting right now is that you buy your scooty and you travel on your scooty. So again, we just started this. We've had about 12 women apply for these scooties and they are now using them. But we need to do more on that. So we are trying to role model change for women in the institution at all levels. Well, I think the first thing that inspires me are the clients that we work with at Kashf. Because every day they get up, day in, day out, the drudgery and the rigor of their life. You know, I often say this to people, that if I gave you $3 to survive in a day, you couldn't. And when I say survive, that means you meet all the needs of the 8 other family members who live in your family. How will you manage? It's the women who do it every day. I mean, if you're talking about financial management, they have it right down to the T. So I think the fact that they are still continuing and they are looking towards a better future and they want to transform their lives despite the challenges they face. And their challenges are just insurmountable in many ways. And the fact that they come out of these challenges and they can still smile and they are still hopeful and they still thank God for every day that they have. I think that's inspirational. Their stories, and there's so many I could tell you, are just inspirational. The second inspiration I draw that I often draw from is the people who work with us at Kashf. Again, these are people who are phenomenal. They represent Pakistan. They're young people mostly. They come from government schools, from public schools and colleges. And they really, really, once they have an opportunity, they really want to, they go places. It's just phenomenal to see the transformation. We have, you know, we have people who came in as cleaners in our office, as support staff in the office. And today they're branch managers because we gave them the opportunity and we gave them the dignity and self-respect. And we said, you know, you are as important as anybody. You're a team member. And then they felt, oh, we matter too. And then they invested in their education. And ultimately, they applied for another position and moved on. So I think it's that camaraderie that we have in the institution that's also inspirational. But primarily, my inspiration comes from the women that we work with because they are just phenomenal. There's no other word for them. Well, there are several projects we are working on. One of the largest projects that we scaled up last year was our program on health insurance. As you know, even the United States is struggling with how to make universal health insurance available to its citizens. In Pakistan, social security is pretty thin, and health insurance is not available for low-income families at all. I mean, some, but not most. So we decided to innovate in this space. And we are the first microfinance institution in Pakistan actually to have scaled up a health insurance product that covers the entire family of our clients for $1.50 per month. So every month they pay 150 rupees to us. It's like a saving, but it covers the entire family for any hospitalization, for tests, for any income loss for up to 10 days. It also covers the family for, you know, if they need to get an ambulance to get to the hospital. So we have currently covered about 1.3 million individuals through our health insurance program. It's currently the largest health insurance program for low-income families in Pakistan. So that's been a, we feel very proud of this. And one of the interesting things we saw in this program was that 65% of the users or claims were coming from women. So we got very surprised because the actual population divide is 50% because, you know, we are covering entire families. So on average, 50% were females and 50% were males, children included in this. And we saw that 65% of the claims were coming from women. So this really struck us as unusual. When we went out there, we discovered that now that women knew they didn't have to pay out of their pocket, they were actually availing hospital care when they needed it. Prior to this, if they needed it, they'd go to the local, you know, quack or dispenser, or they'd go to the local healer, or what have you. They would not go to the hospital because they felt, you know, this was going to use family resources. But the moment they knew they had cover and this wasn't going to come from, you know, this was going to be insured, they were insured for this, they started then going to hospital and getting their, you know, issues resolved, their health issues resolved. So this was an interesting, we had not perceived this to be an outcome, but this was something where we saw women felt they had more control on that financial, you know, because of that financial risk mitigator in the form of insurance. So that's something we've been working on. I've already mentioned the low-income, low-cost school program we run. We have about 1,000 schools that we now support, where we not only provide, financing is always the easy part, as we've already tried. Designing a product for a particular segment has been done before. It's the quality side. So in the quality side, what we do in schools is we're actually doing teacher training. Because one of the issues that we, when we did research, we discovered is that 100% of these teachers were A, underpaid, B, untrained. So we couldn't do much about the underpaid, but we could definitely do something about the training piece. So we do basic training initially on the pedagogy of learning. It relates to how do you plan a session, how do you deliver the curriculum, how do you manage the class, and so on and so forth. So we do basic training on learning and teaching for these teachers. And we've seen that as a result of this, enrollment in these schools over a year on year has gone up to over 30%. So these schools have enhanced their capacity for, you know, for getting more children in. And as you know, Pakistan has one of the highest out-of-school children. It's the third largest number of out-of-school children in the world. So again, enrollment is a key indicator that we look at in addition to quality. I think the first thing is never give up on your dream. Never do that, because you don't want, if you have an idea, you have a thought, you have a you know, passion for something, always try to follow your passion. At the same time, one is having a dream, the other is putting it into practice, and that's where your challenges will come. So if you want to pursue your dream, you're always going to have challenges. So do not be discouraged by challenges. As I said, every challenge contains in itself an opportunity for learning and an opportunity for growth. Finding money is always going to be tough, whether you're small or big. So you have to, you know, fuel the engine, so to speak. You have to come up with ways and strategies, and you have to believe in what you do. You know, we started very small. We started with 15 clients 20 years ago, and it was just five of us in the institution. And we had an office which was like a quarter the size of the place we are sitting in right now. So it was one little table with four chairs and one computer. And 15 women who we convinced after 6 months of going to them every day and saying, you know, take money to earn money, we'll give you money, we'll invest in your business, start a business or grow your business. And the women will look at us and say, are you crazy? We don't want to work with you. We don't even know who you are. You may have some hidden agenda. We don't understand you. Why are you coming here? You know, we persisted. We were very disappointed, obviously, in the first year because nobody was interested in taking money from us. But slowly and gradually, the idea took, you know, root. And today, there are communities where children have grown up seeing their mother borrowing money, investing in their businesses, running businesses, saving, accessing health insurance, accessing micro insurance and other products. So, and making financial decisions. So there's a whole transformation in their lives as well. So I think challenges, and always, I think the other thing I would say to young people is things are not going to happen in, immediately. It's not going to be pronto. It's not going to be at the snap of your fingers. Everything takes time. There is a natural process of development in everything. So if you think you're going to get things in a hurry and it's going to be delivered to you on a platter, it's not going to happen. I think that's one of the concerns I have with young people. You know, they're always looking for quick change. It doesn't happen. I think it's got a lot to do with social media. We've become a sound bite civilization. And I think we need to change that. We have to be mindful. I think that's a term that I have reminded myself recently as well. Because there's so much happening and managing your work-life balance and everything, you're also trying to put you're doing little activities and you don't see the bigger picture. So I think one of the things my message to the younger generation is see the bigger picture. This may seem like a small slot, but actually there's something happening around you. So be mindful. Be mindful of your goal, be mindful of your dream, and be mindful of the little things because you only live once. Thank you to UKVibe.TV for listening to my success story today. If you want to get in touch with Kashf Foundation, you can visit our website, which is www.kashf.com. And in case you want to write to us, you can write at info@kashf.org. We look forward to hearing from you.
Many miles away from home, steps were difficult, I'm exhausted. But I did not fall, I hope. Something good is coming up. Free like a bird, but also bound up. And my footsteps on the ground. I raise my head, listen to the sounds. I'm happy with what I have found. Just breathe, just breathe, just breathe.